Welcome to Bod's Mayhem Hour. Your source for all hard rock, heavy metal, new metal, alternative, punk, horror punk, hardcore,
rock,
and all local bands with your host, John the Bod, a.k.a. The Bodfather.
Hey, this is Jason Rockman from Slaves on Dope, and you're listening to Bod's Mayhem Hour.
The views and opinions of the guests do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of Bod's Mayhem Radio Network, its staff, affiliates, or sponsors. Parental discretion is advised. Welcome to Bod's Mayhem Radio Network.
Hey everybody, welcome to Bod's Mayhem Hour. I'm your host, John the Bod, a.k.a. The Bod Father, and as always, I'm bringing you guys awesome interviews. And today I have Mr. Jason Rockman. He is the vocalist of one of the bands I truly like called Slaves on Dope. They're out of Montreal, and they have their last album came out in 2012, Over the Influence. And if you haven't got a chance to listen to Slaves on Dope, I suggest you guys and gals get out there, get off your asses, and check them out. So, Jason, how's it going, my friend?
I'm good, man. I'm good. Thanks for talking to you.
Glad to have you on the show. Like I said, I've been a big fan of you all since Ozfest 2000. I got to see you guys, and it was a big eye-opener for me to watch you guys play and perform. So, with that being said, let's jump right into Over the Influence. And I know this has been a couple years ago since it's been released. Favorite tracks off this album for you, man?
For me, I really like Pork Sword. It's one of my faves. I like Pork Sword a lot. I really like Careless Coma. To me, I think it's one of the best songs we've ever written. It's really different. It's moody. It's kind of sludgy. It was a lot of fun to do that record. So, I mean, I have really good memories from that record. Just to me, it was kind of like a rebirth, and it was doing Slaves on Dope the way we should do it if we were going to continue. You know, we were taking a bit of a break, and to come back to Slaves on Dope with that kind of an attitude when we did that record was what it's all about for me and what it's continued to be about. It's really, it has to be from the right place now. Because I have a career doing other stuff now besides music. And I really, really enjoy doing music again because it feels like it was when we first started. We're doing it because we just love doing it. And there's no expectations. There's no, oh, I hope we get this tour. I hope we sell this many records. It's just really about doing it because we really love it. And that's why that album was so much fun to do. And it's hard for me to pick favorite songs because I really, really, you know, I like all the songs on that album.
So when you guys took the break, did you think that, you know, this may be it for Slaves on Dope, or was it just a time just for everybody just to regroup?
Oh, no, no. When we took that break, that was it. I mean, there was no Slaves on Dope was done in my mind. Mm-hmm. I had kids and I was just like, no, I'm done. No more music for me. And I was fine with that. You know, I had no, I didn't really look back with any kind of regret. Finding, you know, getting back in touch with Kevin and restarting our friendship for the right reasons, just obviously because we had so much history with doing music together that it naturally started to creep back in, and that's when we started writing again.
So how much growth have you seen this band go through, you think?
Oh, tremendous amount. I mean, you know, when we started out, you know, the band's always, we've always had the attitude of forward motion. You know, if something starts to be stagnant a bit, then we really look at it. It's kind of like a business. You know, we look at it and we take an inventory. We say, okay, where are we at? Like every 6 months we'll look at it and go, okay, what are we doing? Where are we at? What's working? What's not working? And if things aren't working, we'll make the necessary changes that you need. And it's not necessarily changes in personnel or changes in, in musical styles, but it's just change in attitude. And I think what we've managed to do since the band started back again is have a very positive attitude and have zero expectations. You know, we were one of these bands that did it a lot. Like we were on the road a long time. You know, we were on the road for almost 11 years straight. When you look at it, all we did was tour, and we just really wanted to go back into Slaves on Dope for, you know, like I said, for the right reasons, for the reasons we did it at the beginning. So I think we really grew in expectations. You know, we were a little more realistic with our expectations, and I think we came back to where we started, which was kind of nice.
How hard do you guys push yourself to come up with something new from song to song that's not out there already?
We don't really think about that. I mean, it's honestly, we don't think, oh yeah, okay, this band's doing this, let's try to do this. It's really whatever music Kevin comes up with, and when he brings me an idea, we'll try to, you know, I'll try to sing stuff over it. That's pretty much the way it works. I mean, I don't think, he might have a different answer than I do, but I don't think either one of us really look at it and go, okay, what's working now? Let's try to do what they're doing. It's just what feels right to us. And a lot of the time that could be, it could be the worst thing in terms of this, you know, of the trajectory or success of our band. I mean, I know that when we put out Inches from the Mainline, people really liked that record. A lot of people connected with that record. And then when we came back with Metaphor, the album was very different. There was a lot more melody. There was a lot more singing. It was a lot moodier. It went up and down a lot more, and some people just fucking hated it. and that's okay. I mean, it's okay because we did what was right for us. That's how we were feeling at the time. That's what we wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't about trying to get more radio play. It was just, this is where we're at. This is what, you know, what feels right. This is what we want to explore. And we'll always be like that. We'll do what feels right.
What do you hope the fans take away from any Slays on Dope album that they purchase?
Just the honesty that's there. The you know, obviously it'd be nice to be appreciated for the work that goes into it. I think nowadays when bands do records, you know, there's a lot of work that goes into it. There's a lot of behind the scenes stuff that people don't realize. And I shouldn't say nowadays, because that's how it's always been. You know, there's a lot of work that goes into making music that a lot of people that just will hear it don't really realize. And that's why I'm so supportive of so many styles of music. And I try not to hate, because I know how much work goes into any body of music and any composition. It's you know, it's somebody's best efforts that are put forward. So I think I like the idea of people walking away and saying, hey, you know, that's a good record, that they put a lot of work into that, or hey, it's not a good record, it's not what I like, but I appreciate the work that goes into it.
People can now record in their own houses or their bus or whatever, or even driving down the road, yeah, in the backseat of a car or truck or whatever. But you're right, there is a lot of stuff that goes on behind the scenes that us folks out here don't get to see, and you guys get to see that firsthand.
Yeah, that's it. And if you've never, you know, been a part of a band, and you don't really know what it's all, you know, with the amount of work that goes into it, it's mind-boggling. And especially if you're a band that's out there touring and trying to make it, you know, make it your living, it's hard. It's hard, especially now. It's a lot harder than it used to be. But at the same time, it's easier to have complete control. And if you treat it like a business, and if you're smart, you can actually make a decent living.
Jason, what can fans expect at a show from you guys who have not got to see you already?
A lot of energy. When we play, we lay it all out. I mean, I know myself as a front man, I go out there and it's like a different person, you know? The guy you're talking to now versus the guy that's on stage is just a totally different person. It's like a part of my personality that comes out and then goes away when he's not on stage. And yeah, I think most people that come to see us will appreciate us live. And I think that's what was always our strong point. You know, you saw us on Ozfest, and a lot of people, mm-hmm, saw us that summer had never heard of us. It was their first experience with our band, and we left an impression, because we're the kind of band that we've been doing it for so long. If you put us in front of a room, we'll win the room over.
When I got to see you guys on the Ozfest up in Columbus, and this is funny, and I'll remember this to this day, you were doing Inches from the Mainline, mm-hmm, and you stopped during the middle of the show, got the fans up and started talking, and this girl just like was up on this guy's shoulder, and she just flashes. I was like, well, how about that?
Yeah, that was fun.
I was like, I wish I could do that.
I don't know how comfortable I would be with that now with my kids, you know, on the side of the stage, but, you know.
Yeah. That's, like but I said.
Yeah, there was a time when people loved doing that.
Yeah. Like I said, man, that show really left an impression on me, that's for sure. So.
Yeah, me too.
For you guys in Montreal, do you guys still get a lot of support there from the locals?
You know, yes, we do. I mean, I work in media here. I have two radio shows in Montreal, and I do a lot of work in media here. So we do get a lot of help. You know, a lot of it because of what I do job wise. I mean, it definitely helps us open doors. That's for sure. Like any band, their local, you know, your hometown's always the toughest place. We always did better when we got out of our hometown and went and played in other places. Like, you know, when we moved to Los Angeles, we finally felt like we were at home. And we felt like we really had found where we belonged. And I think that's, you know, it's always going to be a part of us. LA is always going to be a part of me, because it just was so much of a part of the growth of the band at that point, you know, of getting to that next level, whatever that next level was. So, but Montreal was where it all started, and it's funny how the rebirth of Slaves on Dope started again here. We're both, you know, Kevin and I are both based out of Montreal. We're both, you know, we both have jobs here where we're very happy doing what we're doing. Kevin has a studio and he produces bands, and so Montreal's, you know, again, an important part of the band. But yeah, support wise, you know, we've got a good fan base here, but it's nothing like in the U.S. I mean, whenever we go into the U.S. and play, and it's been a while because, again, you know, we both have such tight schedules to get out and do shows and tours. Mm-hmm. It has to really make sense for us to leave. It's always better when we get out of the when we get into Canada, for sure.
Now you guys just played Heavy Montreal too in your all's backyard. Yeah. How was that, man?
That was great. It was great. It was a great experience. It was great to see old friends on tour that we hadn't seen in a long time. And, you know, we saw the guys in Cold Chamber. And what's fun is that I interviewed a lot of bands that were on the tour on the show because of what I do. I have a radio show with the rock station here in Montreal called Shome. So I did a lot of interviews with a lot of the bands, and it was fun to meet some of the bands that remembered our band. You know, like I was talking to Randy Blake from Lamb of God, and he remembered Slaves on Dope. The guy from Billy Talent remembered us. I talked to Monkey from Korn, and he remembered the band. So it was fun to see. You know, it's always fun to go down to talk to some of these guys and say, hey, yeah, I remember when you guys started out. I thought you guys were from L.A. And you guys are from here, and it's always interesting when that happens. But it was a great weekend. It was great. We got to see Faith No More. We played the same day as them on the same stage. So that was a big career highlight for Slaves on Dope professionally, for sure, because they're one of our favorite bands.
So now you're doing the radio thing now. Doing that, do you like that better than actually getting out and performing, or what? Man, let's talk about that a little bit.
I do like it a lot. I really like what I'm doing, and that's why it's hard for me to focus fully on Slaves, because I really enjoy what I do professionally.
Yeah.
You know, I love helping bands. I love being at a radio station on the other side of things where I can give the bands the support that I didn't get from radio when I was starting out. You know, we had very few radio stations that supported us. One of the big ones in the States was WJJO in Madison, Wisconsin. I mean, Randy Hawk and Oz at JJO were just instrumental in getting Slaves on Dope heard in the U.S. And I'll never forget that. And to be able to be on this side of it, you know, on this side of things, and to be able to help bands out, it's great. It's really, really fun.
I'm glad you said that, because I'm doing the same thing, just like you.
Yeah. There's a band in Montreal called Half Moon Run, and they're just a phenomenal band. And, I was one of the first guys to play them in the city. And as a result of getting support from our station, their album went gold, and it was the first gold record I got as a DJ, and it felt great. It was a really nice feeling to have that on my wall and say, hey, you know, I played a part in your success. And I look at it as, you know, I could be in the band, and I could go out and I could try to get, you know, try for my band to achieve as much success as it can, or I can work where I'm working and I can get 20, 30, 40 bands a chance to have that kind of success. And that's a lot more gratifying.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing, because, you know, I felt like there wasn't, even though I'm just an online radio DJ, I still feel like that's a little voice for these local bands that don't get airtime for, you know,
absolutely,
like these bigger outlets. And that really ticks me off, because some of these bands are legit, man. They're actually working their asses off to do this.
Yeah, I mean, listen, we you know, as radio DJs, we're up against a lot of things. We're up against format. We're up against corporate expectations. You know, it's at the end of the day, it's all about business. And I get that. I understand that. And there's formats that we have to work in within, you know. And I try to do as much as I can for bands. You know, I try to help metal bands out as much as I can. We're obviously limited because we're not a metal station. But whenever I can sneak them on, I do.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Oh, for sure, man. Are you guys working on anything possibly new or no? Or?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no. We're working on our new album. It's called Horse. And it's done. It's just a matter of us finishing tracking. I mean, our drums are done. Guitars are done. Half the vocals are done. And Kevin's away right now. But as soon as he gets back, we're going to finish up the vocals. And we're going to hopefully go to mix in the fall and get it out in early 2016. So, yeah, no, there's an album on the way. It's coming.
I hate to keep going back on this, but I just want your thoughts on this, Jason. What did it mean for you guys to be on that Ozfest tour? Because let's think about everybody that we've lost on that tour that's made a huge impact in the metal world, like Dimebag Darrell, and plus, you know, Static X's frontman. You know, that sucks, dude.
You know, it's crazy when I look at just that year and then the year after, the people that aren't, you know, that are no longer. I mean, there's a guy in Crazy Town that passed away. There was a guy, you know, obviously Dimebag, Dimebag was killed, and then Static X with Wayne, and there were other people too, like Drowning Pool, Dave from Drowning Pool. Like, it's crazy when you realize you know, it's crazy, but at the same time, you know, if you were to pull together that many people and just look at the trajectory of what happens in 15 years, people die, you know,
yeah.
And it's reality of life. But yeah, it's, I mean, Dimebag was just completely senseless. That was just, I mean, that was just a crushing blow to Metal. And to, you know, he's just such a damn nice guy. You know, I didn't know him very well, but I had, you know, a handful of personal dealings with him, and he was just such a good guy, mm-hmm. You know? I think my best Dimebag story was when we were on tour, and we had Drowning Pool opening up for us, and he showed up because he was a really good friend of Dave, the lead singer, and we went into his limo after, which was funny, and he was passing around shots, and they had these Jägermeister Pantera shot glasses, and he looked at me, and he said, do a shot, and I said, I don't drink. He goes, why aren't you going to drink with Dimebag? I go, well, I don't drink. I mean, I'm sober a long time. So he grabbed the shot. He did it and then gave me back the shot glass and said, here, you can keep it as a souvenir. And I still have that shot glass. And I, you know, that was the kind of spirit that he had. You know, he was just a fun guy.
Yeah, that was the famous.
And he just loved the music. So when that happened, I remember I wasn't doing music at the time, but I was really sad, really, really sad. And then obviously, you know, when Dave from Drowning Pool passed away, I mean, that was really sad. It was like, you couldn't have asked for a nicer guy to know. He was just so sweet. And that's the reality of that kind of lifestyle, though. It can be hard on people, you know?
Yeah, that was Don Beck's famous.
Static, I mean, Wayne was one of the reasons why Slaves on Dope moved to California. I mean, we met Static X and Fear Factory on tour in Montreal, and I remember going back and talking to Wayne and then talking to Dino, and both Wayne and Dino were like, here's some phone numbers if you move to L.A., here's some clubs you need to play. Here's some of the promoters. And we took all those numbers, and when we moved, we called out these people. We got shows. So they were really instrumental in us making that move from Canada to L.A. So Wayne passing away was just fucking horrible.
Yeah, I was shocked when I saw that. That kind of blew me away. I was like, you got to be kidding me, man.
No.
I mean, I'm first and foremost, I'm a fan of music, period.
Mm-hmm.
And you see, I wouldn't say idols, but people you look up to as far as musically.
Yeah.
And you see them passing away, it just makes you think, like, you know, time's short, and get off your asses and go see these bands while you can.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I mean, you never know what's going to happen. I mean, life is short, you know.
Jason, my last question for you, my brother. What's it mean to you guys when you receive an email, still to this day, from a fan, or prior to a show or after a show? They come out and tell you that Slaves on Dope's music has helped them through tough times. It's gave them inspiration to overcome obstacles. What's that mean to you all?
A lot, man. You know, I'm one of these guys that really believes in talking to fans, and even calling them fans is kind of weird. Like, you know, I look at them more as friends and as supporters, and I really enjoy connecting with the kids. It's always been the thing that meant the most to me. Always, always. It always has been, and I've always been really, really nice to people when I meet them, because I'm a music fan like you, you know. I meet people that I like musically, and I get excited, you know. Like, I want to ask them questions, and I want to tell them how much their music means to me. And it's really exciting when you get to talk to your idols and your heroes, and to think that I'm somebody's hero. I mean, that's something you got to take with a lot of respect and with a lot of care. And I've always held that in the highest regard. You know, if I ever meet somebody that likes our band, and you know, I always try to make them feel at ease right away and let them know that, hey, man, it's cool. Like, let's chat, you know, always. And I talk to people on Facebook all the time. I'm always welcome to add people and chat with them. And it's important, you know, it's important. A couple of years ago, I had all the Slaves on Dope stuff, and I know I posted on Facebook, you know, anybody want, you know, anything, you know, just send me, PayPal me postage, and I'll send you an envelope full of shit. And I remember I sent out like 75 envelopes of stuff. People were so happy, you know.
Yeah.
I just had all this stuff lying around. I'm like, well, I got to give it to people that want it, and, you know, I'm not going to try to sell it to people. I mean, it's just stuff that's lying around. It was like old tour passes and picks and all kinds of crap, but it was great. It was nice. They were really happy, man. That felt good too.
Like I said, man, first and foremost, I'm a fan of your guys' music, and thank you guys for your music and still what you're doing today, Jason.
Pleasure, man. Nice talking to you.
How can people stay in touch with you guys to find out when some new stuff's going to be available, merchandise, plus your festivals that are coming up? You're getting ready to play another festival here, I guess this month, maybe, or next month, possibly. How can you do that?
You just go on Facebook, Slaves on Dope. You can always find me on Facebook too, The Real Jason Rockman. Or, I've got a public page. You can just add me there, and all details are always there.
Before I let you go, will you care to do a promo for the show?
Yeah, of course. Hey, this is Jason Rothman from Slaves on Dope, and you're listening to Bod's Mayhem Hour.
Everybody stick around, and you only hear these interviews right here on Bod's Mayhem Hour. Go out and support Slaves on Dope. Go check them out. Buy their merchandise. You won't regret it. Thanks, Jason.
Hey, pleasure, man.
Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.